I want to introduce you to a couple this morning who have completely surrendered to God. And as a result, they have seen the Lord do great things. Charles Crabtree served as a pastor and is the assistant general superintendent of the Assemblies of God. It's recognized as the second largest Protestant movement in the United States. It's even larger all over the world. Reverend Crabtree has served as a leader in this movement because he is a servant of Almighty God. And by his side, every step of the way, an anointed woman of God who will share a tremendous blessing with us as she uses the gift that God has given in song. Would you please welcome Ramona and Charles Crabtree to Radiant Life Church.
This is a very special day for me. I don't know if I enjoy anything more in ministry than a mission's emphasis. I I have believed that God can use these faith promises in so many wonderful ways that it is just incredible. And one thing that I like about faith promises is, have you ever heard anybody say, all the church does is ask for money? Have you ever heard that before? Well, in this case, I will tell you that the church is not asking for money for themselves. The church is asking for the kingdom of God to be advanced through the church. And not one penny goes to this church, but it is a sacrifice of faith to reach out to the entire world. Isn't it a fantastic thing that God has raised up a network of people around the world that will bring the King back, that he will come in his power when all of the world has heard the gospel? And that's happening right now. We are on the very edge of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, the final fulfillment, when all of the nations of the world will hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this church is a part of the prophetic word of the living God. And that is one reason why faith promises is absolutely, absolutely important and fantastic in my thinking. Now, the Lord did not say there is no blessing in receiving. Did you notice that? He says that it is more blessed to receive, no, more blessed to give, but there is blessing in receiving. If you don't think so, you should be around our grandkids at Christmas time, and you should see the joy on faces when they receive unexpected surprises. It is wonderful that we can receive so many wonderful things. But the principle is there against the carnal, against the non-spiritual. He is saying to us, I want you to think about money in a whole different way than the world thinks of it. I want you to understand that God has a principle in this money thing that the world has turned to idolatry instead of obedience. And we ask you this morning to remember a few things. Why should I give a faith promise? The first reason is that you should give a faith promise because by doing so, you acknowledge that God is your source, not money. Money is not a source, it is a resource. And God has placed money into your hands to receive glory and honor and praise and all that is necessary to worship him with money, not to worship money. Because there's a difference between a source and a resource. When I was growing up in Maine, and you can see I almost made it, I loved milk. I loved real milk. I don't like what I see when I go into the grocery stores these days. They have everything they call milk, but I don't. And they have it, you know, they have it in cardboard. Can you believe they put milk in cardboard? When I was growing up, they put it in glass, real. Oh, I can still feel it. And they had real milk. We didn't understand this 2% business. Why would you want to pay money for 2%? And then, oh my word, it's even worse, isn't it? They have this stuff that's called 1%. And then it's worse than that. And I hate to bring this up in mixed company, but a depraved thing called skim milk. Now, friends, that is not milk. That is damaged water. And real people drink real milk because you are what you drink. But when I was growing up, I drank milk, and I was absolutely a professional at drinking milk. I could take a quart, that real milk from that cold, oh, it was incredible, that glass, I can still feel it. And I got to where I could guzzle almost a quart of that without taking it off my bottom lip. It was just, and I know you're sitting there just amazed at this man that's standing here now, that I could do such a thing. But I did. And I would have it about 2 hours before going to bed. It was just, it was just wonderful. But what could you imagine if I went and reached in to get that milk and there was none? You know what I would do? I would fall to the kitchen floor in a fetal position, and I would cry and say, I will never drink milk again. It's all over. I loved it so. No, you know what I did? I'd scream, Dad! See, the refrigerator was my resource, but my dad was my source. And as long as my dad was alive, I knew I could have milk, even if I didn't have it. Do you understand that God is your source? And even if you're out of resources for a time, the fact is that our God is still alive. He still loves you. He has promised to take care of you. He has told us very clearly, has he not, that the birds of the air, all of us together, can trust in the living God who made us and created us. And these young people sitting on the front row, let me tell you, God loves you. He wants to take care of you. You can trust him, and there will be times when your faith will be tested and you'll want to just lie down and say, I don't have any money, I don't have, and especially when you get your grades, you just feel that life is over. I want you to know that our God is bigger than your problems, bigger than anything that you can imagine, and if you'll trust him and believe and have faith in him, he is going to take care of your needs according to his bank account, according to his possessions, and the cattle on a thousand hill belongs to him, so the hamburgers are going to come in the near future anyway, even if you can't have them. Amen. You keep that in your mind, that our God, hallelujah, I could get excited right now. I want you to know that the devil wants us to look at what we don't have, and we need to look up and rejoice in who we have, for we know in whom we have believed. We are persuaded he is able to keep that which we have committed unto him against that day. And not only have we committed our souls, we have committed our lives. And because of that, our loving Heavenly Father, even though there's interruptions, you know what those are? Those are simply tests for a few minutes to build your faith. I want you to know that, secondly, that faith promises. Think about that. This is an opportunity for you to not only have faith, but to use faith. We've got a lot of people that are in our churches today that can say doctrine, they can tell you what is in the Bible, but it has no practical application in their lives. Their statements of faith is simply an open door to use that faith. And faith without what is dead? Unless it's at work. It's dead. Why? It's because it abides alone. In other words, faith by itself, isolated from action, is dead because there is no purpose beyond the statement. But the statements are there with a purpose. Don't you know that you are to understand that your faith needs to go to work whether it's in school, whether it's in work, whether it's at home, your faith is supposed to be applied. And I've watched a lot of people that could quote Bibles. They could quote all kinds of truth, but their lives didn't live up to it. They did not use the faith to overcome temptation. They did not use the faith to build their characters. They did not build their faith in order to witness and to touch men's lives and in order to give according to what God asks them to do. It's just wonderful for people to say, oh, I believe in missions. Oh, thank God, I believe in missions. But that doesn't change one blessed thing unless you are willing to use your faith in missions, God's command to say, I believe in it so much, God is my source, I'm going to step out and do what I believe God wants me to do, and watch him go to work. When you exercise your faith, you know what? The faith that we have overcomes every obstacle, and it brings to you a living faith where life is fresh and alive, and spiritual living is exciting, and it is so beautiful to see people who are flowing in the faith of God to the point where they are willing to use it. Do you understand what I'm saying? Have you ever seen a grouchy grandpa? A selfish grandpa? It is a thing that is just against nature. Do you understand it? That your grandparents are pretty good? Okay, you'd been around this. All right, okay. Take a big gulp and shake your head. Yes, okay. But it is not normal for people who love to be tight, to be ungiving, because ungiving is a proof of their unloving. And when we say we love God, but in works we deny him. Hello? We say that we know God, but it's not working. We are saying to everyone else that it is dead being alone, and I have watched rich people, very rich as far as the world's. I have been in touch with billionaires, and I have had to counsel, Pastor, I've had to counsel multimillionaires because their lives are a mess. Their faith is not being used. Their love is not complete. And their lives have dried up, and they've got nothing but money. Think about that. They have nothing but money. They have mistaken the reason and the purpose for wealth. It is not to keep, but it is to give and to love and to have peace and to have joy and to have the contentment that God promises to have, so that we can live day by day. Every day we die so that he can live. Isn't that marvelous? We want to die, Lord, today so that you can live through us in a real applicable faith that refreshes life every single day. I've had the joy of being in Israel, and I have visited Galilee. I love Galilee, surrounded by beautiful foliage. I've taken a boat across, watched people fishing, and it is just it's a beautiful setting, and it's a beautiful experience, and it's just is one. Well, Galilee's water goes into the river and then down to a place called the Dead Sea. And the Dead Sea, I want you to know, when you go there, you will affirm the fact it's dead. I mean, surrounded by desert. There's nothing alive about it. It's separated from its purpose. And you know what? There is no richer place on earth of natural resources than the Dead Sea. Just billions and trillions of dollars worth of stuff. But you see, everything around it is dead because everything in it is dead. And when a person is Galilee, they are giving, they are flowing, they have died to self, believing that the God who put water in there will continue supplying that water so that in turn they can give into life. But there are people who take God's resources and just hold it, and eventually they die spiritually. And unless you use faith, you will lose it. Hello? If you don't use faith, you will lose faith. And I am asking you today to recognize, first of all, that God is your source. So don't look at your bank account right now, but look at the God who has made it possible for you to have one. Then I want you to understand that he has brought you into a place of faith where he wants you to have more from him than what the world can offer. And if we will exercise faith in him and say, God, this is not my decision, it is yours. And if you ask me to give, I will give it by faith, knowing that you will take care of me. Why? Because you love me and you care for, and you're my source of life. And if the God of heaven says, you give the just give this little transitory bit of money that you have, give that little bit, I will take care of it. And I love the guy that he practiced this, and he came to a group of young people because he was such a fine Christian man. And he said to the young people, like these sitting on the front row, he said, you know, when I was your age, ever hear that? When I was your age, I remember that I got a bit of a job, and I began to come to church. I got saved, and God really touched my life, and he changed my life. And I had very little money. And I came to church one day, and the Lord said, I want you to put everything you've got into the offering plate. And he said, but Lord, you know, you have the feeling, but Lord, I won't have anything. And the Lord spoke to him a little bit and said, yeah, but you'll still have me. Hello? Hello? But you'll still have me. And so he said, you know what? I gave it all. And you know, from that day, I have prospered and God has blessed me. And one of these smart aleck kids raised their hand and said, yes. He said, mister, could you do it again? And that's what God is saying to us. It isn't your past. It's what you do today. For faith is the substance of things you don't have. It is the faith that is the substance of things not seen. You don't see it, but glory to God, because your God's alive, you have it. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for, and it's the evidence, hello? It's the evidence of things not seen. And I am here today simply to bless you. I am here to try in my own spirit and my own heart to bless you, to lead you to a new dimension of spiritual life and victory. I am not here to receive money. I am here to present to you the God who is able to meet your practical practical needs, because there are so many people living today who say, but this faith business and God is, you know, God is, it's a theory. He's a theory. He's something that the doctrines and all of this is just a theory. But I am here to announce to you, it's more than theory. I am presenting life-giving faith so that you can grow and develop and be blessed from heaven rather than looking to the world to bless you and to keep you and your resources. And so today is a day that we celebrate because it goes beyond the tithe. We thank God for the tithe. That is the basic need for the local church, and God has a way of providing, doesn't he? As we obey him and we pay our tithes. But over and above tithes, there is the blessing. The tithe is the obedient, but giving by faith is really the blessing. If you say, well, I don't have it, glory to God, you have an opportunity to exercise faith like nobody else in this building. You see, I don't have it. No, but thank God you know somebody who does. And you know somebody who loves you that does. And you know that somebody will never run out of those resources. Oh my goodness, I'm running out of time. But let me wrap it up in the next hour, shall I? There are people here believing that. But thank the Lord, you don't have to believe in me. The fact is that as we pray and we think about giving this morning, and faith promises, but this is a faith promise, we're going to ask you to, in a few moments, to fill this out. And we will never be contacting you. I know this pastor for sure that he would not even think of contacting you and saying, well, where is your faith promise? We haven't received anything. This is between you and God. And the reason we ask for simply a name and the amount, we will never write you, we'll never contact you. We simply need to know that this faith promise is from a credible person, because there are people that will take this and use it as a carnal joke and fill in some kind of an amount without a name. We just simply want to know that this is from a person that is really credible, and that God is at work in their lives and they allow God to work in their lives. You understand? So that it is between you and God, and they will not mention it to anyone. They will just simply do the totals, but they will never, never mention it. And as you sit there this morning, I want you to think for a moment what God wants to do through you. You are just interested in the past so often, aren't we, that we're interested in what God will do for us and to us. But we have a tendency not to ask what God wants to do through us. And as you have this faith promise and God speaks to you, God speak to you in an audible voice? Nope, he speaks louder than that. And when we pray, he is going to give you an amount. And I love my friend Will Balch from Bethel Church in San Jose when I was pastoring there. Very, very wealthy man. And he was sitting there praying at Faith Promise time. And he was thinking, boy, I think I'll give this amount that God wants me to give, that amount. And something said to him, you can't afford that. No, no, no. And he said, you shut up, devil, or I'll double it. I love that kind of thing, you see. God wants to bless you. He wants to double your faith. He wants to build your faith. And he wants you to know that when you walk out of here with less money, but in his hand, you are going to be richer than you've been for a long, long time. And I just can't, that the stories that come out of Faith Promise Sunday is just incredible. We had a little lady at the church I pastored, and she had had a terrible experience in marriage, had two children, and this so-called husband of hers came to her one day and said, "I've decided that I want to marry a man." And he had talked to him, and he said, "She has been a wonderful wife. She's just, it's nothing to do with her or the children. It has everything to do with I am just attached to the homosexual lifestyle." And do you know that she continued being faithful? She came to that church with very little income, and she had to work hard at Hewlett-Packard. And she came on Faith Promise Sunday, and God spoke to her and said, "I want you to give a certain amount of money." And she said, "Lord, you know." We don't have to say that, do we? "Lord, you know. He knows you. He knows everything about you. You don't have to remind him that he knows." She said, "You know, I've got these two kids. I have to stretch to pay my tithes. And I do it, Lord, but there's not a penny." And he said, "I know you don't have it, but I do. And when I ask you to give, you know, that's what I'm saying to you this morning. You don't have it, but he does." And I love it especially when kids sitting on the front row don't have anything. They can tell you they don't have much money. They sometimes don't have any. And God speaks to them. Like the little girl in Arkansas came to church barefoot, didn't have anything. And God spoke to her to give and said, "I don't have anything," but that childish faith, and she gave an impossible amount. And she and her grandma had started making doll quilts. And her friends saw the doll quilt, and they said, "Can we have one?" And by the end of the year, she and her grandma had made so many of these that she was able to pay her faith promises and have more for herself. When this little lady came with these two children, "I don't have it." And he said, "Yes, but I do." And I know this story because I lived it with her. The next week, after she had given the impossible, she got a call to see the supervisor. And she walked in, and so afraid. And the supervisor said, "Sit down, I have some good news for you. Accounting has sent up word that we miscalculated." "And we don't usually give raises in midterm or the mid-year. It's a policy, a company policy. But what we're going to do, we're going to start giving you monthly what you should have from the past to catch up for the new," and it was the exact amount that she had, trusted God with, the great accountant. "And I want you to understand that we use money so carnally, don't we, as Christians, that if we're not careful, we will say, it is according to what I have or what I can do or what. And this is why Faith Promise Sunday goes so far beyond this moment. It touches every part of this church. And as people, Pastor, begin to believe God for money, you know what they're going to do? They're going to believe God for souls. They're going to believe God for new things and wonderful things, and this church will grow and flourish. I do not know a church that has been faithful in faith promises that have not flourished in every area. And we are here to turn loose, and I want you to say to the devil today, you shut up, devil, or I'll double it. And I want us to begin to believe God and to trust God and to keep that in our hearts right now as we begin to pray. And I don't want you filling this out until we pray. And what we're going to do is we are going to fill this out, and I'm going to fill one out myself to get through this church. I can use the pulpit for something. Oh, good. We're going to pray, and then I'm going to fill mine out, and then while I'm doing it, I want you to fill it out after we prayed. And I've asked God to speak to me what I should give through this church. And I want you to believe and pray with me. And now just take the lid off and begin to look to God and say, Lord, you put in my heart, I'd love to be able to give that much. Well, you just go ahead, and you go ahead and do it by faith, and the Lord will help you. Shall we pray? And do you have your cards out now? Do you all have cards? Does anybody not have a faith promise envelope, a card? Anybody? Is there somebody that doesn't? Sister over here doesn't have one. Do we have an usher that can help her? Raise your hand if you don't have one of these, because this is something that's worth more than anything that you've held for a long time. All right, let's pray. Now, Lord, we say so often that you're our source. And we say so often that we have faith. But how hesitant we are sometimes, and we confess that fear takes hold when we act upon that faith, when we choose to get out of the boat at your command. And I pray right now in the name of Jesus, you will begin speaking amounts into every person in this room today. Touch them. Touch them right now. You speak, Lord, as we listen. What would you have me give? By faith, not by my bank account, but by faith. Through you, we will do it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you're ready. You write down here, let me see, weekly faith promise. I am going to put new here. It's going to be a one time, and then I'm going to print my name. Please print your name, because Pentecostal people write in tongues too often. Print your name. And you don't have to sign it. And then put the amount right here. There we go. So you don't have an address, you don't have a city, state, or zip, or you don't have a signature. So by now you should be done. Amen. And we'll turn it to the pastor.
Thank you so much, Reverend Crabtree. Would you just express your appreciation to this great man of faith? So much. We each have our faith promise card, and I trust that you have prayed and heard from the Lord, because he provides. I invite you at this time, as the ushers return. Bow your heads and let's just give thanks to God as we place these cards into His care. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your great love, for Your mercy, for Your grace, and for Your provision. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that as we walk forward as a church, we would be able to make an even greater investment in the kingdom through our missions giving. God, we trust in You to provide for every need exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever ask or imagine, and we commit to giving You all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Those of you who will be joining us tonight at the missions banquet, I will receive those cards after this service and total up our missions faith promises, and we will celebrate what God is planning to do through Radiant Life Church tonight. Are you ready for that? And I believe we have a celebration in store. I don't know about you, but when I ask God, Lord, what would You have me do? He loves to stretch my faith. This morning, as Ani Yancey and I were talking, so what is God putting on your heart? No, you go first. I'm sure that didn't happen for any of you. No, you go first. And I think we were both feeling very much pulled in the same direction, but we wanted to kind of baby step to get there. You know what I'm talking about? So, all right, God, You're expecting us to do more than we've ever done. How about a little bit more? God, we can do a little bit more than we've ever done. We'll take a step in that direction. And we waited till this service. Say, how big of a step is God really calling us to take? You know how I'm feeling, right? Many of you do. As you step out and you say, this is a bigger step than I've ever taken in this area. But God has always been faithful in the past. And I believe this promise is true for every single one of us. God is faithful.